talk in religious circles now about how America is approaching a new awakening in religious fervor. Take a walk through history with me for just a moment. Religious historians write that the type and fervor of religious belief is cyclical. Okay, so the Middle Ages started us off with the Age of Faith. It's referred to during that period as a time when intense belief reigned. And then we had the Reformation, and that was called the Age of Revelation, where religious people renewed their emphasis on the revealed word in Scripture. Then came along the 17th century, and we had the Age of Reason, because we had people like Thomas Jefferson who were arguing for the power of the mind in critiquing religion. The 20th century has been called the Age of Experience, as charismatic faiths grew and blossomed and exploded, and modern Americans have looked to experience religion. And now, scholars are saying that they believe the 21st century will again be the age of faith, where intense belief reigns. So it seems that our religious experience is one of journey. A journey that began much, much longer ago with the movement of God's people, the movement of God in people's lives. So today we go back and we remember the story of Abraham and Sarah. They set out for a place, not having any idea where they were going. They lived a nomadic existence in tents, setting up no permanent home as they went along, but always looking forward to a future that had a city based on foundations. They were seeking a homeland. Theirs is a journey of faithfulness. And then fast forward several centuries to the early Christian community. They were exploring what it means to be faithful to Jesus. And it was not easy. Following Jesus seemed to set them at odds with the surrounding culture. Most of them experienced hostility or ridicule or shame, or if not worse, even being put in prison for their beliefs. They were also discouraged and having a great bit of struggle holding on to the hope that Christ was going to return immediately to them. So wow, we've got, in fact, a journey that finds faith and a very multifaceted reality. It has lots of mystery and paradox and change. And so today, we invite ourselves to join the journey, to see how the age of faith may be for us. Faith is God's gift of unconditional love. And it is our human response of trust and gratitude that lives out our faith in deeds of love and justice. Faith is a way of knowing that constantly seeks understanding. It is faith that leads us into our own study and prayer and devotion and reflection and guides us into our belief about God and Jesus and humanity. Faith, in fact, is that which is often believed to be what will enable us to cope with the trials and tribulations of our lives. And faith is also sometimes that which has provoked hostility and ridicule being heaped upon the Christian community. And so we have all of that big picture and many ideas about what faith is for us. And to us, then, we hear the author of Hebrews today. He writes to a community that is searching and struggling with what their experience of faith is for them. And I think he speaks to us as well. So let's continue our journey and explore the question, are we, or how are we, living in an age of faith? To talk about faith, we must begin with the individual person, you and me. For many of us, there are few things more important to us than our faith. Or for those who are new to faith, it is a journey of exploration and discovery. To use church language, it is by God's grace, through faith, that we receive salvation. Faith in God is what keeps us going through the face, the joy, the struggle of life. Our scripture today gives us a valuable definition of faith: the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Let's think about that together for a minute. In this description of faith, we are reminded that what we hope for is intimately connected to our experience of faith, the assurance of things hoped for. We all hope for things. We all yearn for things. And in faith, we often ask God for things. Sometimes our prayers are answered. Children are born. We get the job. The treatment works. The surgery is successful. Sometimes things take longer. And like the community who was waiting for Christ's return at any moment, we are still sometimes waiting for an answer. Like Abraham and Sarah, who waited for so long for an answer from God, they struggled, I expect mightily, but they obeyed God and stayed true to God so much that they followed God without knowing where God was leading. It's difficult for us to follow God when we are not sure where God is leading. It's true for us as individuals. It's true for us as a church. We worry. We get anxious when we do not perceive evidence of God in action. We begin to wonder whether God is watching over us. We can make a long list of worries. I bet you could all be pretty good at that, along with me. We can make a long list of worries like health concerns, or the economy, or the choices that our children make, issues of our aging, the future of our church, will there be enough money, and on and on and on. And then we can top off our list of worries, realizing that we should not expect that our faith will be supported by the surrounding culture. And so we then struggle with the choices we make in how to live out our faith that may challenge or be different from other values in the culture. So it can be difficult to follow God. And then, every once in a while, something positive happens in our faith. Something special that restores our conviction and strengthens our hearts and reminds us why we believe what we believe. I think of two illustrations. While we were on vacation, Rick and I traveled the back roads of Pennsylvania into the Amish country. Some of you may have had the privilege of seeing or sharing with the Amish community. We witnessed the faith conviction of the community that held to their beliefs of simple living. People in plain clothes, horses and buggies, laundry hung out on the clothesline. How many of you have done that lately? plowing the fields with a team of horses, living out their faith in a way that for many stands in conflict with the popular culture. And yet, not only does it not deter them, it binds them together into a faith community. We were driving along the road one time, and it was evening, and happened to see a church. And the churchyard was just filled with what I would say were teenage girls and boys in their long dresses and their black slacks and their hats, playing volleyball. It was evidence to me of their faith community reaching out to the youth and living out their faith. Another experience that I have had this summer has been witnessing right here in Silver Lake United Methodist Church our children's summer Sunday school. If you're not aware, each Sunday this summer, we have had a member of our church who has volunteered to meet with the children and share their faith story. It has been a marvelous opportunity of the young and the old meeting together in the journey of faith. And I don't necessarily mean old in years, but older than the children. The children were so enriched by the stories of our faithful members, as was I. And they also enjoyed knowing that we could all sing the same songs together. Deep and wide. Some of you have known that since you were this high, and the children in our church who are this high know it too. Our members, each of us, have meaningful and touching stories to share. We are a blessed community of faith. Faith matters. Our faith gives us the assurance that God has our best interests at heart, and that God knows what we hope for, and God holds our future. Through our faith, our convictions are restored, our hearts are strengthened, and we are reminded why we believe what we believe. We live in hope. But that's not all. In faith, we often have to trust God and other people, to trust with our future, to find assurance outside of ourselves. That's the second part of this definition of faith, the conviction of things not seen. That's belief. Believing in something is what faith is about. Our faith is a gift of God's grace. It comes through God's reaching out to us, loving us, forgiving us, caring for us, providing for us, claiming us as God's own children. Our faith is our firm belief in God's benevolence toward us and the conviction and the certainty that God cares about us all. 2 centuries ago, in that age of reason, when most people lived on farms and made their own clothes and raised their own food, perhaps at that time it was easier for people to be sort of an island of themselves. But today, we have to have faith in the people around us. We have to trust the food prepared in the restaurant where we're eating. We have to trust the pilot of an airplane. We trust the provider at a daycare center. We trust in the congregation to support our church. We trust in our friends and our family. We trust when we live in relationship. And despite the claim that faith is not sight, the conviction of things not seen, it can be helpful to think of faith as a kind of seeing. Many come to faith by seeing something compelling in the life and teachings and resurrection of Jesus, or seeing the examples of the communal life of Jesus' followers. That's us, the church. So it is our faith, then, that is the belief in the way of Jesus that is the way to become who I most truly am. A creature made in the image of God. It is our faith that propels us to love God and our neighbor. So the way of faith is the way of courage. It may mean standing up for what you believe. It may mean challenging the values of the culture in which we live. It may mean living the struggle or the tension to sustain some alternative vision amid our social norms. It does mean trusting that God is with us even when we don't know exactly where we are going. It does mean joining together as a community in worship and deep friendship to come together at a banquet table where all are welcome. It means living in hope, seeing the wondrous beauty around us that is already here and all the new possibilities. It is courage for us as the faithful to live responsibly and meaningfully and gratefully in the world that God has given to us, and to share that love and grace of God that we have received with all of our neighbors near and far. So the journey of faith continues for each of us, for all of us. Will this be the age of faith for Silver Lake United Methodist Church? When others look at us and the way that we live, will it be obvious that our faith guides our words and our actions? Let this be our prayer and our conviction. Amen.